Newt Gingrich on technology, next on Behind the Headlines.
This is Behind the Headlines, with behind-the-scenes analysis on issues affecting Pennsylvanians, sponsored by the Susquehanna Valley Center for Public Policy. Now, here's your host.
Hi, welcome to a new edition of Behind the Headlines. I'm Charlie Greenewalt, Senior Fellow for the Susquehanna Valley Center for Public Policy. Today's show, we're going on location to Millersville University, where former U.S. House Speaker Newt Gingrich will be speaking to a government class. Let's listen in.
I like being in classrooms, so this is fun. And it's a good excuse for me to actually talk about ideas. So I want to talk to you. I wrote a book a couple of years ago with Nancy Desmond called The Art of Transformation, which is really a workbook on how to think about very large-scale change. And what I thought what I would like to do today is share with you what I think is probably the largest political governmental challenge of your generation. And one which I have frankly not been able to solve. And so it's one I'm going to spend a few minutes and sort of outline a way of thinking and then toss it open and let you take it where you want to, and we'll talk about it. But let me start with a couple of examples. Are any of you old enough that you've actually used a mimeograph machine? Okay, you have in the back. Do the rest of you even have a clue what I'm referring to? Okay, I want to start here because it's a pretty good example of what I'm talking about. In the olden days, they had machines that had ink and had a drum, and you would either write or type on a master, and you'd put it over the drum, and then you would either manually or electronically run the drum. And it would print out, for example, tests in high school or tests in elementary school, what have you. Now, this was considered very fancy technology after World War II. And people were, you know, this was the state of the art. Let me go to sort of the next phase. How many of you have ever actually sent or received a fax? Okay, so that's still a little more common, right? But how many of you now would not send or receive a fax normally because you'd send or receive an email or Twitter or Facebook or something? Do you see what I'm referring to? So take this kind of sequencing for a minute. All right. The thing that's fascinating to me, and I'm going to try to just show you this for 1 second. I describe transformations as watersheds. I first got this years ago. If you look at the Olympia rainforest in Washington State, it's very cool because it's a temperate rainforest. What happens is the water comes in the clouds from the Pacific, and as they go up the mountains, they dump all the water. So on the western side of the mountains, you have this huge rainforest. Now, it creates what's called in geography a rain shadow, because on the east side of the mountain, the clouds that get over the top of the mountain have dumped almost all their moisture. So literally on the west, you know, you would carry a raincoat, and on the east you'd carry a canteen. And it's that big a change. Now, when you watch really big cycles of change, it becomes a mountain range, so that you get a first wave of change here, and then a second wave of change, and then a third wave of change, and by here you're in a very different world. So take, for example, if you go back and look, there's an old movie called Sabrina, which is done about 1955. And in the movie, Humphrey Bogart plays a very rich guy. And you can tell he's a very rich guy because in his car, he has a radio phone. And the way a radio phone worked, you literally picked up the handset, and a radio signal went to an operator. And you gave the operator a phone number. She then connected your radio into the telephone system. Now, in Sabrina, this is used as a symbol of how really rich he must have been. And he then goes from there to riding on a helicopter. just as further proof. It's a romantic comedy in which ultimately he gets the girl, he and the radio phone. Now, come up about 35 years to the original Wall Street, which I suspect some of you have seen on rerun. And there's a scene where the rich guy is walking on the beach, and he is talking on a cell phone. Have any of you ever seen this scene? You know what I'm referring to? His cell phone is the size of a World War II walkie-talkie. And again, it's a sign, boy, this guy must really be powerful and wealthy. He has a freestanding cell phone. Now, cell phones were introduced in 1970. So let's say this is the radio phone, and this is the original cell phone, introduced in 1978 by Motorola in Chicago. Large, very poor batteries, weak reception, clunky. Then you get the next generation cell phone, then the next generation cell phone. Now we get to your cell phones. First of all, just as a test run, how many of you have a cell phone? Okay. Is there anybody out of here who does not have a cell phone? I'm just curious. You do not have a cell phone. Is there a reason?
Just don't feel the need to be contacted.
You don't feel the need to be contacted all the time? Do you get mail?
Yes.
Okay, sorry.
Pony Express.
Pony Express. I'd probably check and see, you know, how far into this you were. So take this model, okay? Now, how many of you have taken pictures with your cell phone? Okay. How many of you do text messaging? Right? How many of you text message more than you email? Okay. So start thinking about how this thing works. How many of you actually take movies with your cell phone? Does that use up a lot of battery power? So you can't do it for long. Right? A modern iPhone is about a 2002 computer, laptop computer. Same computing power. My wife uses her iPhone almost ubiquitously. And when she doesn't use an iPhone, guess what she promptly gets on? It's in an iPad, which is a bigger version of an iPhone. And then occasionally she now gets on her laptop. But she doesn't use the laptop very much. She uses a stand-up computer at home that's literally a home computer. But her laptop, I don't think she even carries her laptop anymore because she doesn't need it with her iPad. I resisted iPads for months, and I now use an iPad. I actually carry, show you how whack this can get. Okay. I have here my cell phone, which looks like a cell phone. I have a BlackBerry, which is also a cell phone. But that way I can read email while I'm talking. And then I have my iPad to see the things that I want to look at that are bigger than I was comfortable to look at on a BlackBerry. Are you with me so far? Now, here's what I want you to think about. The most effective way to think about the future. Okay. We'll call this the present. Do not try to go forward from here. You jump out here, we'll pick a reasonable date. Let's say 25 years from now, okay? So we're gonna come out here, this is 2012. We're gonna come out here to 2037. And what you do, in the words of a good friend of mine who at one time headed the Army's development program for the Army of the Future, you go up on a hilltop and you look at the totality of the future. So you say to yourself, I'm now in 2037. What's it like? And how does it feel? And what's the rhythm of life? Now there's something, barring an enormous war, I mean minor wars don't count for this kind of patterning. Barring an enormous war, there are certain things you know are going to be true. Computing power will keep going up. Moore's law approximately works. And so you're going to get a continuous doubling of computing power. Wireless is going to be total. I mean, every place on the planet, for all practical purposes, will be a hotspot. And so you'll be automatically connected everywhere. Now, if the computing power goes up, and remember, computing power is actually speed times storage capacity. So what you're going to have up here is massive capacity. Here are some just interesting things to think about. I'm very big on brain research. I think it's one of the topics I have not been able to drive into the campaign. And I'm interested in brain research at one level because it is Alzheimer's, autism, Tourette's syndrome, Parkinson's, brain injuries, mental health. I mean, when you take all the different things your brain does for you, and you think about various malfunctioning brains, and then you translate it into human cost, how much is your life reduced because you have a brain problem, or a member of your family has a brain problem? And then you take it into financial cost. Alzheimer's alone is $20 trillion, not billion, $20 trillion from now to 2050, bigger than the entire national debt. So I'm intrigued with brain science. Well, it turns out every brain in this room, each individual brain, has about as many neurons as there are stars in the known universe. So the two largest uses of mathematics and science are studying the brain and astrophysics. If you're trying to understand all the stars in the universe, you use a tremendous volume of computational power. And if you're trying to understand your brain, you use tremendous quantity of computational power. In fact, the estimate we got, I met with a group of specialists, including a couple of Nobel Prize winners. Their estimate was that in order to be able to understand the volume of data we're going to get about brains, you have to have two revolutions of computing power from where we are right now. So we would drown the computing systems with information, because what's happening is we can now look into, you know, we can now watch you with an MRI. We can see a living brain. 25 years ago, we'd never seen a living brain. The only brains we saw were dead. And since everything that matters about your brain involves being alive, there's a very limited amount of knowledge you get out of dead brains. Now, I'm sharing this with you for a minute because all of a sudden here you're in an intermittently connected world. Here you're going to be in a totally submerged world. So let's say you have diabetes. By 2037, you'll have some kind of device that will constantly monitor your blood sugar. You won't even think about it. And it'll tell you when you need to take insulin, or it'll tell you when you need to drink orange juice, or it'll tell you when you're getting into a problem. It's a very different world. It also changes how you learn. Because all of a sudden, you can learn continuously. For example, how many of you still buy textbooks? And are they paper? By 2037, none of them will be paper. They'll all be, in fact, if we were clever, this is an example of what I'm talking about in terms of crossing a watershed. I testified in 1995 that we ought to give young kids computers. That literally, if you take a child going into kindergarten or first grade, you could give them the computer and upgrade their books every year for less than you're going to spend on the textbooks. And at the time, it was seen as radical and crazy, and how could you talk like that? And a couple years later, actually the state of Maine undertook that project. Well, if you think about it, the number of things that start to happen. For example, how many of you watch video on either your cell phone or on some other device? Okay. Part of what this means is the print will diminish, because you learn faster by watching video, or you learn more often. You enjoy it more. I mean, ask yourself, how often do you end up watching some kind of a video as opposed to reading the same information? And yet we don't currently bullet that. I should have asked you, how many of you have some kind of device in addition to your cell phone? Either a laptop or something, okay? Now let me apply this now to state and local government. My assertion for you to think about is, if you just took what you do every day, how many of you use an automatic teller machine? An ATM, a money machine with your cash?
Sir.
Raise your hand, how many of you have cash teller machines? Okay. So ubiquitous, right? My argument is, most governments, state, local, and federal, is over here. Much of your personal life's now over here. So the accuracy, the speed, the efficiency that you deal with over here is at least a generation ahead of the government.
Behind the Headlines will return with more from Newt Gingrich after these messages. Behind the Headlines is brought to you as a public service by the Pennsylvania Business Council, envisioning a commonwealth in which residents enjoy a very high quality of life in sustainable communities. The Council works aggressively to define key long-term policy strategies and solutions that make the Commonwealth more competitive, creating and sustaining a better Pennsylvania. Additional underwriting provided by the Worrell Corporation Foundation, based in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, by the Edward H. and Jeannie Arnold Foundation, and by the Hospital and Health System Association of Pennsylvania, helping hospitals to provide healing, health, and hope to communities across the state. And by the Pennsylvania Manufacturers Association. Business in Pennsylvania is our business. Behind the Headlines is also supported as a public service by Daily Underwriters of America, a better way for truck insurance. And by Penn Waste, your best local choice for your waste removal and recycling needs.
I'll give you just one example that affects both state and federal government. Over here, the American Express system tracks your purchases in real time. How many have ever been called by a credit card company to make sure you were actually using your credit card? Okay, you have anybody else? You have, okay. Raise your hand if you have, I just want to get a feel for that. So again, this is not a theory. In real time, they can track and they say, gee, how come you're paying for something in Sacramento and Scranton in the same hour? Okay? They pay 0.03% to crooks. The federal government, which is back over here, has a paper-based 9-to-5 bureaucracy. Remember, for American Express to work, or Visa or MasterCard about the same, they're 0.06. For them to work, it has to be ubiquitous 24/7. Because who knows what time, you know, you're going to decide to use your credit card. Over here you have a federal government which is still paper-based, 9-to-5. Competing with crooks who are using iPads. The result is, according to the New York Times, New York State Medicaid pays over 10% to crooks. And when I say crook, I mean a dentist who filed 982 procedures a day. Now, this means you are 330 times or 33,000% more likely to pay a crook as a taxpayer than you are as a credit card holder. And to show you the scale of this, I'm just giving you one example, but I want you to think about this. It's one of the most interesting problems intellectually I've dealt with in my career, and I do not have a solution for it. The amount we're talking about here is between 60 and $110 billion a year in Medicare and Medicaid. So you could make the argument that incompetent, obsolete government cost you in one zone alone between $60 and $110 billion a year. That's $1 trillion over a decade. Begins to be real money. I think it's probably larger than all the student loan repayments. I mean, this would be a great thing for some class to take up. You know, if the federal government simply diverted the money from the crooks to the students, they could wipe out all the student loans. Because I'm trying to get you to see that this is real. This isn't just funny money. This is real cash. We wrote a book which we thought would work. This was at the Center for Health Transformation. One of our modest failures of getting through to Washington. We wrote a book entitled Stop Paying the Crooks. Now, I thought, being naive, that was a sufficiently clear title. That it would work. But here's what happens. People who are over here are numb. So they go, oh yeah, that's one more book about waste and fraud. Everybody knows you can't deal with waste and fraud, so it's all baloney, so don't waste your time. Meanwhile, in the modern world, American Express, Visa, and MasterCard stop waste and fraud every day. But in Washington and Harrisburg, they can't even think like that. Does this make sense so far? Are you tracking with me? So part of what I want you to think about is, you come out to here, and you start saying to yourself, 25 years is a long enough time horizon. You can achieve big things in a quarter century. If we had adopted, 1983 is the last time we dealt with Social Security. If we had allowed young people to have the right to choose a personal Social Security savings account, which is what Chile has adopted, and it's what Galveston, Texas, and two other counties have adopted, we would have today $16 trillion in personal Social Security savings accounts, about the same size as the national debt. Now, this is not a theory. I mean, Chile exists. You all can, you know, pull it up on Wikipedia. They have a real, they have this program. It actually works. Galveston, Texas exists. It actually works. But again, it's a question of where you are in life. If you're over here in the old order, you go, well, that's really weird. If you're over here, you go, that's really obvious. Now, I'll just give you one last example just to give you a flavor for this. Because this, when you're thinking about state and local government, the problem you have, this is a huge problem. It's a problem also in healthcare. You go in to learn from the experts. Okay, the experts are all describing the world that's dying. But that's the world they know. Their capital investment is over here. So if you go in and say, yeah, but why aren't we talking about this? They'll say, well, that's not government. So in effect, you get caught in a cycle where the things that work can't be discussed because they don't count. And the things that count won't work. And that's really where we are. That's where we are at the federal level, the state level, and the local level. So one of the most interesting and important challenges of your generation is, can you figure out how to take things that are obvious, that are all around you, and draw them into rethinking education, health, government bureaucracy, the environment? I mean, all the different things that we want to deal with in life, creating jobs, competing with China and India, all these things, if you're doing it over here in the modern world, you're in a totally different world than if you're doing it over here. I'll close with one example. The odds are even money that by the end of this decade, we will have broken loose again. By the end of the decade, if we do the right things, we'll be the most dynamic economy in the world, we'll be the largest producer of energy in the world, and we'll be pulling away from the planet again, something which you've done 5 or 6 times now in our history. The example I want to give you is the Boeing 787 Dreamliner, which is assembled in Charleston, South Carolina. I want you to just think about this in terms of complexity. They've taken 4 Boeing 747s, and they've extended the top of the hump all the way back. Now, the reason they did this is each of these 747s carries one piece of the 787 Dreamliner. So they build the Dreamliner. I just want you to think about this in terms of the modern world. They build the Dreamliner in 4 places. And imagine this as a case study in complexity in the world that's emerging. So a piece of it's built in Italy. A piece of it's built in Kansas, in Wichita. A piece of it's built in Japan. And a piece of it's built in Korea. They then fly these 4 pieces. This is an airplane. They then fly this airplane in 4 pieces in the guppies to Charleston, South Carolina, where they're assembled. Now, the plane arrives, and they bring it together. First of all, it has been designed and executed so accurately that even though it's built in 4 different countries, it fits. I mean, if you think about it, this is moderately amazing. They then wrap it. This is the first composite aircraft for commercial purposes. It's what we built the shuttle with. It's what we built the B-2 and the F-117 with. And composite, so it's essentially a plastic. And they literally have this giant roller machine that goes all the way around the airplane, putting on this, it looks like tape. They wrap the whole plane, they then put it in a gigantic oven, and they bake it. when it comes out, the composite is stronger than aluminum, lighter than aluminum, and allows you to do things. For example, when you fly in an airplane, aluminum-based airplanes actually have atmospheric pressure at 6,000 feet. It's one of the reasons you feel tired getting off an airplane. The Dreamliner will be at 4,000 feet. They take out 2,000 feet of atmosphere because they can withstand the pressure. They also have very big windows. So you start changing how an airplane feels because you suddenly have really large windows, which you couldn't do with an aluminum plane because they couldn't risk the aluminum breaking. Now, so we're there, we're walking through, and we get to a particular place, and they're assembling all this stuff. And they use a model called Lean Six Sigma, which is a management system. There was one particular place that currently takes 16 days. Their goal is to reduce it to 6 days with the same number of workers. And I looked at that and I thought to myself, imagine if you applied that to government, or if you applied it to universities. I mean, what happens when you say, we want to increase productivity so much that something that used to take 16 days now takes 6? Now, because we're doing this everywhere in manufacturing, I mean, there are actually no sophisticated manufacturing companies that don't use some variation of Lean Six Sigma. We're rapidly becoming the lowest cost manufacturing country in the world. South Carolina and Alabama will be cheaper than China, than coastal China, by 2015. It'll be less expensive to manufacture. The explosion in natural gas, which you're seeing in western Pennsylvania, means that the price of natural gas in the U.S. will be the lowest cost energy of any industrial country in the world. And it'll probably add 600,000 jobs. And what I'm suggesting to you is you want to take the kind of innovation and the kind of breakthroughs that you see everywhere now in your world. And you want to say, so what would local government look like? If you designed it from the ground up, what would education look like? What would the university look like? How do you take cost out of the system? What if we designed a textbook program to be the lowest cost textbook program in the country? How much could we take out of the cost of going to school? And how would you do that? And you can tell because you go to Amazon and you pull up, you know, what do books cost? What do e-books cost if they're not a monopoly? Do you see how you suddenly have changed the world? So the challenge for your generation is going to be to say, okay, I'm actually going to be living over here in this new dramatic world, but I'm still working over here, so how do I take this and migrate it to the new world? If we successfully do that, we'll have a renaissance of really effective, really dynamic government, and not just government in the bureaucratic sense, but how we solve problems collectively as a community, how we get things to work as a community.